celebrate 50 years since the war on poverty. And for those of you who had the opportunity to listen to today's speakers, I'm embarrassed to say that I was there 50 years ago as a special assistant to Sergeant Shriver to Ted Berry, and working with Edgar Kahn and others to set up neighborhood legal services around the country. I was involved in the District of Columbia, but I must admit to you, my most favorite assignment was Puerto Rico. I actually got to go to Puerto Rico to help organize during the winter. I can't remember what year it was, but it was a hell of a long time ago. With those short remarks, allow me to introduce, who doesn't need an introduction, the dean of this wonderful law school.
My name is Shelley Broderick, and I'm the proud dean of the UDC David A. Clarke School of Law. And if you are a DC resident, that's your tax dollars at work. Okay. Some years ago, we received the highest level of accreditation, and I said at that time, now that we have the American Bar Association's boot off our neck, it's time to turn our attention to ending poverty and inequality. You're all here to help us do that. We had a wonderful symposium with profoundly important speakers. Peter Edelman was one of them, Jim Sandman, John Smith, and that's just the last panel with our fabulous professor, John Britton. All day long, we worked on thinking about strategies and other efforts to end poverty and inequality. It's important work, and that's why we're here. I do want to just say a couple of things about the law school before we move on to the main attraction. As you know, our mission is to recruit and enroll students from racial, ethnic, and other backgrounds traditionally underrepresented at the bar, and to represent the legal needs of low-income DC residents to the maximum extent feasible through the school's legal clinics. So how are we doing with all that? I'm happy to report that we've gotten a whole bunch of 2014 top rankings. In Princeton Review, number one, most welcoming to older students. So if you look around this room, some of you all are students. Some of you all are students. We're in the top 10 for best environment for minority students. We're in the top 10 for most liberal. We're only eighth for most liberal. Come on. That's crazy. We're number two for most diverse faculty. We got it going on. Our clinics were just moved from 10th in the nation in U.S. News and World Report to 7th. Look out, we're going up. We represent hundreds and hundreds of the most vulnerable residents in the District of Columbia through our 8 amazing clinics. We represent children with special education needs and those in the abuse and neglect system. We represent people with HIV/AIDS. We represent seniors, immigrants, tenants fighting illegal rent increases, tenants seeking to purchase and renovate their buildings, and on and on. We support the DC Council with progressive legislation, which is no easy task. We work on federal legislation as well, and on. We've just added a criminal clinic. This is a deeply service-driven law school. 30 of our faculty and students just got back from Mississippi and from the Arizona-Mexico border, where they were representing vulnerable people in service learning on an alternative spring break week. And I'll tell one last thing. We've just launched this year the Black Farmers Discrimination Project. As many of you are aware, the United States Department of Discrimination confessed to discriminating against black farmers. They, what happened? It's been kind of a long day. I'm sorry, I heard some tittering. Okay. The United States Department of Agriculture discriminated against thousands and thousands of black farmers. And there was a class action suit, and settlements were given to the black farmers, only they fell. Nobody told folks about the tax consequences, and it was an unmitigated disaster where people were in trouble with the IRS. But the other problem with that case is they forgot 15,700 black farmers and had to refile the suit, bring another suit, and settle with those folks. So this time, they wanted to make sure folks got some tax advice. And our students and our alumni have come together to do a video, a call center. We've already spoken to more than 3,000 of members of the class, providing some tax guidance and support for those folks. So look at our website. It's an amazing project we're very, very proud of. Our tuition is $11,000 a year for DC residents, and you can become a resident in a year. Our tuition is $22,000 for out of state. There are 26 law schools over $50,000 a year, so we're remarkably affordable. We're on the red line. We have a part-time program, a full-time program. Spread the word. We want to let this little gem be better known. With that, I just want to thank all of you for being here and say, Joe Rauh would be so proud.
Thanks, Shelby. Good evening, everyone. Good evening. I'm Wade Henderson. I'm the Joseph L. Rauh Jr. Professor of Public Interest Law here at the David Clarke School of Law. I also serve as the President and CEO of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights. The Leadership Conference is the nation's leading civil and human rights coalition, with over 200 national organizations working to build an America as good as its ideals. It gives me really a great pleasure to welcome you to the law school for the 22nd annual Joseph L. Rauh Jr. Lecture, and to introduce a dear friend and colleague, U.S. Secretary of Labor Tom Perez, as this year's lecturer. Now, it's a tremendous honor for me to serve as the first Joseph L. Rauh Jr. Professor of Public Interest Law here at the law school. Joe was a legend in D.C. and nationwide. He believed that a lawyer has the power to affect the public interest in a profoundly positive way. He served for 40 years as the pro bono general counsel of the Leadership Conference on Civil Rights. And as we celebrate, for example, things like the 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, one has to think of Joe's work, his handiwork, and helping to shape that important legislation and serving as an advisor to presidents, to policymakers, and to those of us in the civil and human rights movement to help shape the country that we live in today. Joe once said that what our generation has done to bring equality in law, the next generation has to bring equality in effect. And that remains the big challenge that we face today. Now, these are the lessons that we try to instill in the students of law here at the school. It is our great charge, our mission, to make Joe's dream of a school that would train the next generation of public interest lawyers. And I really want to thank the Rauh family, Mike, Carl, Maggie, the family that has been so supportive of the Rauh professorships and the Rauh lecture here at the school. And I think because of their involvement, we now have a school that really speaks to the idea of creating people's lawyers, lawyers who are committed to social change, regardless of how they choose to practice law or to use their skills. Earlier today, we recognized Dean Edgar Kahn, who was the founder, co-founder of Antioch School of Law, the predecessor school of UDC. Edgar had a phenomenal impact in helping to shape legal services. And on this, the 50th anniversary symposium of the War on Poverty, Edgar was lifted up for that fact. But Edgar focuses on contemporary issues that deal with systemic problems that create poverty. So when we work on issues involving school discipline, policies that disproportionately affect poor kids and kids of color, we're dealing with the systemic problems that today help perpetuate poverty. So I was really proud of the Law Journal for having focused its symposium on the War on Poverty, looking back, looking at how to renew that, you know, vital effort, and talking about the challenges that we face instead, and what it did over a 50-year period to really both isolate those in poverty, making it harder to eradicate the conditions that existed, but also helped to plant seeds that are now bearing fruit in a very changed environment that 50 years ago could not have happened without the sacrifices of many of the men and women in this room. Certainly, Dr. King's dream of addressing poverty and doing so in a really direct way. After all, he died trying to bring increased worker benefits to sanitation workers in Memphis. Could ask me, Local 1733. That, for us, is the kind of legacy that continues to shape these events. So, look, in some ways, the challenges that we face 46 years after Dr. King's death are similar to those that Dr. King faced in 1968. We're a nation emerging from a decade of war. We're struggling from the growing pains associated with fully integrating a diverse population into the fullness of American life. And we're suffering from grave economic challenges here at home. But we also have some toxic partisanship in Congress that makes achieving the kind of change that we would all like to see happen more difficult to accomplish. So, it gives me great pleasure to be able to introduce one of our finest soldiers in the fight for economic security and economic opportunity, Secretary of Labor, Tom Perez. We could not have gotten a better speaker for this occasion. I had the pleasure of introducing Tom as a keynote speaker last fall at our Half in 10 campaign event with the Center for American Progress and the Coalition of Human Needs. It was on the release of an annual report that we issue, tracking our nation's progress toward cutting poverty in half in 10 years. Tom spoke eloquently of his commitment to workers' rights and about how labor and anti-poverty advocacy are vital to civil and human rights in this country, and about his lifelong commitment to public service. Now, Tom's career in public service is extraordinary, and he is one of the few individuals that I can point to who has had literally a career at almost every level of government, local, state, and federal. He served as a law clerk for a federal judge, as a member of the Montgomery County Council, an advisor on civil rights to the late great Senator Edward Ted Kennedy, a prosecutor in the Civil Rights Division of the Department of Justice, and later as head of that division, and also as Maryland's Secretary of Labor, Licensing and Regulation. In every position, Tom has been a fierce and dedicated advocate for working families, for people of color facing discrimination and prejudice, and for immigrants who are too often exploited by a broken system. We're living in a time of growing income inequality, which has long been a primary concern of the civil and human rights movement in its ongoing work to expand opportunity and to provide security for the most unfortunate among us. So those of us who have had the pleasure of working with Tom over the years are thrilled that he is now in this extremely important role as Secretary of Labor, where he has already begun to make a critical difference in fostering policies that really bring the broad systemic change that I talked about earlier. I'll end this by noting only in one area where Tom has made a huge difference in the year that he has been there. Tom helped promote and extend the Fair Labor Standards Act to home health care workers for the first time in history. These are people who, generally speaking, have been underpaid, undervalued, underappreciated in our system, and often exploited because they are unable to get the kind of worker protection and fair labor protection that they deserve. The change really removed a nearly 40-year-old exemption that denied basic minimum wage and overtime protections to millions of home health care workers who have become a booming part of our economy, and yet they make a median wage of about $20,000 a year. So it really means a lot that in 2015 these workers are going to begin to make a bit more money. And then one final point. Just as Dr. King would have been fighting for this increase in the minimum wage that President Obama has talked about, bringing it to $10.10 an hour, not very much, guys. After all, the money that he argued for in 1968, when he was assassinated, he wanted a $2 minimum wage for those workers in Memphis, Tennessee, that would have amounted to $15 an hour under today's pay. $15 an hour. So 10-10 is not a lot of money. But Tom and an army of advocates trying to change have been really pushing that change. And so it really is a pleasure and an honor to welcome our friend, Tom Perez, to the podium.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Great to see you all here today. And it is an honor to be back here at this wonderful school. Wade, thank you for that very, very kind introduction. And Dean, thank you for your leadership. I have a wonderful connection to this school and wonderful affection for this school. And I want to thank the Rauh family for your leadership and for continuing the legacy. You know, the Rauh name isn't just a name, it's a brand. You know, and it's a brand that stands for fairness, inclusion, and opportunity. That's pretty good when your name becomes a brand. And so I really want to say thank you. You know, I started working in the Civil Rights Division in the late 80s, and the law school that had the greatest representation of attorneys in the section where I worked was what was then called Antioch School of Law, but we had a bunch of folks who were people who trained me how to be a lawyer. And I, to this day, have great gratitude for how they trained me and how they mentored me. And I remember when I became clinic director at Maryland Law School in 2001, and Maryland has some pretty good clinics, I was seeking guidance on what to do. Who do I call? This Tallman guy, who's got game, you know? And I get back to the Civil Rights Division, and I'm thinking about people to recruit back in 2010. Who was one of the first people that I tried to steal? This guy named Jonathan Smith. I don't know if you heard from him earlier today. You know, he doesn't know a lot about this stuff, but he fakes it. Jonathan is one of the most brilliant lawyers I have met. I had the privilege of serving on his board when he was the head of the Public Justice Center in Baltimore. And again, the footprint of this law school. You said you were small, Dean, but if you are small, I would say that you punch above your weight. Okay? And you're always punching on behalf of people who need your help. And that is why it will always be a pleasure and an honor. And you know, there's one other person with an affiliation in this school that I've been in a foxhole with, and that is your president, Jim Lyons. With whom I served on the O'Malley cabinet. And I would crawl in a foxhole with him as well. He is a man of integrity, and I'm honored to call him a friend. And it really, you know, to the students who are here, you know, you're here because you've made some decisions that you don't want to be just any old lawyer. You know, you want to be a lawyer who, you know, when judgment day comes, you can look yourself in the eye and said, you know, I led a life in which I tried to build a better community. You know, I used to give my students the following assignment on the second last day of class. And that was, I used to ask them to write their obituary. And the purpose of that exercise, and I would do it the second last day, is because it's been my experience in my career in law that all too many lawyers have disproportionate mental health bills because they fail to take that step back and ask that question of, you know, what am I doing here on the planet Earth? And what do I want my legacy to be? And lawyers as a bunch are disproportionately risk averse. I've taken a number of risks in my life, and I'm kind of an oddball because the older I get, the more willing I am to take educated risks because I have led a charmed life. I've had the privilege of doing immigrant rights work, labor rights work, civil rights work, and every day I have woken up, I've loved my job, and I challenge my students every day to find your passion and follow your passion because lawyers don't do enough of that. Fortunately, at the DC School of Law, you do it. And that's why people like Jonathan end up being leaders around our community here in D.C. and in Maryland and in his current job across the nation. And so I hope you'll spend some time and do that and share it with your professor and put it in your drawer. And when you're having a bad day, read it and remind yourself why you're on the planet Earth. I know I did that, and that was helpful, especially on those periodic days where you did wonder. Wade, you talked about the anniversary today, and I was reflecting on what to discuss today, and I couldn't help but start with Dr. King, because, his world, I've had the privilege of following a career path that takes me to civil rights work, immigrant rights work, and labor rights work. And as Wade so correctly and as always so eloquently pointed out, at the time of his death, he was organizing sanitation workers. If you haven't been to the museum in Memphis, I really do encourage you to get down there. It is really remarkable. There is actually one of the trucks is there from the sanitation workers. And you look at that and you see the movement. And I used to have a poster on my wall at my current job from the I Am a Man campaign. That's what people demanding the minimum wage were asking about. I say I used to have that poster because one day recently I was meeting with some low-wage workers who were working in the fast food industry, and they were telling me their stories. One woman was talking about how, I'm second generation fast food, and I don't want to see a third generation in my family. Another person who was talking about how, my employer was going to fire me unless I could get a doctor's note to prove I was sick and not able to come to work. How can I get a doctor's note if I can't afford to go to a doctor? He asked. And I was so inspired by them that I pulled that thing off the wall and I said, you guys are the folks who deserve this poster, not me. So there's a little bit of a hole if you ever come on my wall in my room, and I hope you will excuse that. And though you reflect on these things, and you reflect on what was happening around the time of Dr. King's death, and I can't help but continue to see the interaction and the intersection of labor rights leaders and civil rights leaders, people like Philip Randolph and Walter Reuther and Baird Rustin, the heavyweights of this movement. And the person who, the entity who bailed out Dr. King from the Birmingham jail was the UAW. When Dr. King wrote his I Have a Dream speech, he wrote that in Detroit at the Solidarity Center from the UAW. The labor rights movement and the civil rights movement were very, very closely attached during this period of time. And so, I find myself in the aftermath of Dr. King's death as we celebrate it today. I find myself thinking a lot about this, and I find myself fast-forwarding to that 50th anniversary when Dr. King was being commemorated here and the president was speaking. And what was interesting when we were commemorating this is one thing I learned that I hadn't known was that the involvement of the Department of Labor in the sanitation workers' issues in Memphis was significant. There was a person named James Reynolds who was an assistant secretary of labor for labor management relations, and President Johnson dispatched him down to Memphis to try to resolve this dispute. And with the tensions high and rioting obviously igniting around the country, Mr. Reynolds was able to negotiate a settlement with the mayor that secured a wage increase for the workers and recognition for the union. I've got a photo of Frances Perkins right behind me in my office. She's the gold standard for all labor secretaries. And she is a remarkable woman. And people like James Reynolds are folks who inspire me as well, because they did so much work against such difficult and challenging circumstances. And President Obama at the Lincoln Memorial, I thought, spoke very eloquently on that 50th anniversary. And one thing he said, and I think this is important, was it's important not to overlook the progress we have made, because we tend to focus on the remarkable amount of unfinished business that remains. And sometimes when we do that, we overlook the sacrifice. And as the president said, on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial that day, commemorating the 50th anniversary, it would really do a disservice to those who fought so hard and in many cases died in that struggle to ignore the progress that we have made. Progress that in no small measure enabled a guy named Barack Obama, community organizer, to be the President of the United States today. But it would be equally wrong to ignore the unfinished business. And he said of the original marchers, they were there seeking not just the absence of oppression, but the presence of economic opportunity. And he talked about the idea that one's liberty is linked to one's livelihood, and the pursuit of happiness requires the dignity of work. And he went on to talk about how it is along this second dimension of economic opportunity, the chance through honest toil to advance one's station in life, where the goals of 50 years have fallen short. And he essentially declared economic equality to be the unfinished business of the movement and challenged us all to live up to the ideals that Dr. King set out. And I feel like one of the luckiest people on the face of the earth, because I get to wake up every morning working on these issues. I get to wake up when I was at the Department of Justice, I got to wake up every morning working with remarkable people like Jonathan and others, addressing the unfinished business of civil rights. And that's what we are doing now. And I find myself, as we mark this solemn day, you know, reflecting on a number of questions, which, you know, really for me is, you know, what would Dr. King be saying if he were here today? You know, and I can't help but start with reflecting on the question of what he would say about the status of access to health care for folks in America. I've spent a lot of time on this issue lately. I suspect there are folks in this room because, you know, Dr. King said, of all the forms of inequality, injustice in health care is the most shocking and inhumane. And I am quite confident that he would be here today looking down with great, great admiration of this president for what we have accomplished. Because let me just give you a few facts and figures. 7.2 million people enrolled in the exchanges. And that figure will go up because we haven't even counted the late enrollees into the state. At least 3 million and growing newly enrolled in Medicaid or SCHIP. 3.1 million young adults on their parents' plans. The lowest increase in health care costs in over 50 years. 130,000 fewer hospital readmissions as a result of quality improvement innovations. $10 billion in savings for seniors and others on Medicare as a result of closing the donut hole. That's a $1,200 raise per year that Medicare recipients have gotten. The Medicare Trust Fund has been extended for another 10 years. 10 years. And I could go on and on and on. I don't think Dr. King ever met the Koch brothers. I would love to be a fly in the wall on that room if he did. Because I think he would be telling them, you are on the wrong side of history. Just as Ronald Reagan and others were on the wrong side of history in 1961 and 1962. You know, Ronald Reagan recorded an album. I've got the album cover in my room. And I'm not kidding. I'm not making this up. He has an album that he recorded. Medicare will lead to socialized medicine. I invite you. I'll give it to you if you want. You can listen to it. You need a, you know, you need one of those, I forgot what they're called now. Turn to it. Sorry about that. I don't think this is on an iPod or an iPad. But this is a true story. And by the way, that album didn't simply say that Medicare will lead to socialized medicine. It said, Mr. Reagan said, and by the way, he was a good-looking man. That album, seriously. I mean, he had a head of hair on him that I will never have. So I look at that album with some envy. I just want to be honest. But I will tell you, he said that Medicare will not simply lead to socialized medicine. He said that Medicare will lead to socialism in America. History, my friends, is repeating itself. Except the challenges are greater because we have the 24/7 news cycle. We have unlimited amounts of money going into campaigns. And you know what? The thing we got going for us is the facts and history. And I tell you, I travel this country and I see these stories that I know make Dr. King happy. Stories like, I was in Cleveland last Friday and I went up to the NIC unit. I met this little baby, 9 months old, 7.5 pounds, less than 1 pound when she was born, less than 1 pound, a triplet. Her siblings are doing great. And so is she. She's a month or so away from leaving. Bright-eyed, moving around, you know, doing all that. It was a remarkable scene. And the doctor says to me, you know how much this has been costing? $2.1 million in running so far. $2.1 million. Well, guess what? I leaned over to that little girl. I don't know if she understood me. I said, hi, I'm Tom. It's an honor to meet you. Your parents would be a lot poorer, but for the Affordable Care Act. Because you know what? That lifetime cap, you know? There's a lifetime cap that used to be in place that's no longer in place. And so your parents, and by the way, mother works at the hospital, are able to have a future. That's the Affordable Care Act. And this woman who I had the unenviable task of being introduced by, she told her story. And it's a story that broke my heart. She's a woman who, she and her husband were working. They both had jobs. They lost their jobs. Her husband had a knee replacement. That resonated with me because I'm 2 years removed from a knee replacement. And in the aftermath, he got MRSA. And he has been living with the consequences of MRSA for years. And as a result of not being able to work because of the MRSA, he got fired. And so they lost their health insurance. And she talked about how she had to, among other things, sell her wedding ring at a pawn shop to help pay for health care. You know, and that's just not America. You know, I'm thinking to myself, I got a wedding ring on. I was 12 when my dad died. This is my dad's wedding ring. Wedding rings are priceless. They should never be sold. She had to sell her car in America. And now they have health insurance. A little boy that I got to know of. 47 visits to the emergency room over a 1 year period because he has asthma. And he didn't have a primary care physician. His primary care physician was the ER doc. He got enrolled in Medicaid. Hasn't been back since. Helped his parents out now as well, addressing the underlying causes of substandard housing. His family is now on the road to opportunity. Dr. King would be pretty happy. And Dr. King would be willing to take on those other folks who are on the wrong side of history of this one, who wake up every day trying to make it harder for that little girl to get health care, harder for that little boy to get health care, harder for that Latino family I met in Houston to get access to health care. We're on the right side of history. And we are indeed making access to health care less shocking and more humane. And that's why I think Dr. King would be happy on that score, although he would recognize the unfinished business. I think Dr. King would be sitting here understanding that, you know what, the business of America, the unfinished business of America in the wage context continues. You know, the president has talked about pillars of opportunity, you know, access to good jobs that pay a fair wage, making sure people have the skills to compete, making sure everybody has access to a quality education starting in pre-K, and making sure hard work is rewarded through a fair wage. 75 years ago, Congress passed the Fair Labor Standards Act that set a wage floor. It stood for the value proposition that we should reward work by paying a fair wage. And over the course of the ensuing decades, Congress, in a bipartisan fashion, has always raised the minimum wage, recognizing that nobody who works a full-time job should have to live in poverty. And I have heard, and I agree with the notion that I have heard across an ideological spectrum, that we want to reward work and encourage people to become self-sufficient. Well, when you have a minimum wage today that's worth 20% less than it was 30 years ago, it's hard to live up to that value proposition. Imagine everyone in this room, you got to take a 20% pay cut from what you were making when Ronald Reagan was president. You can't do it. And I meet people day in and day out who are telling me that I have to make choices between a gallon of milk and a gallon of gas. I have to make choices between whether I'm going to pay the electric bill or whether I'm going to pay the doctor bill. That's just not America, I'm confident Dr. King would say. And tipped workers, disproportionately women, more likely to be living in poverty, more likely to be on food stamps. Tipped workers are really getting the shaft. $2.13 an hour. I can't tell you the number of people who say, Tom, I know you're the labor secretary, but I think you got your facts and figures wrong. The minimum wage for tipped workers cannot be $2.13 in the year 2014. And I tell them, yes, it can. And yes, it is. And then I hear the concerns. You know, FDR, when he signed the Fair Labor Standards Act, referred to opponents of the minimum wage as calamity howlers. You hear from a lot of folk of that ilk that, you know, this is going to be the end of the world as we know it. If we raise the tip wages, restaurants will go under. Well, you know what? There's this state out west called Washington State. They've had the highest minimum wage in the United States for the last 15 years. And guess what? They don't have a tip credit. The restaurant workers make the same wage as everyone else. And guess what? Here's a hint. If you go to Seattle, you will find restaurants. I believe Starbucks is based there, last I heard. And you know what? It's a level playing field. And guess what? You look at their economic growth. They have been well above the national average. They continue to grow in that state. You know why? Because they understood what Henry Ford said 100 years ago when he doubled the wages of those on the assembly line. Why did he do that? Well, attrition was 360% or something like that. You can't run a business when you have attrition of that nature. And that's what it was. And you know what else he said? You know, the folk on my assembly line ought to be able to afford the products that they're making. And by the way, when you put money in people's pockets, guess what they do? They spend it. And when they spend it, businesses have to make more things. And when businesses have to make more things, businesses have to hire more people. And when businesses pay a fair wage, like the owner of the Ace Hardware store, half a mile from my office, who owns 9 Ace Hardware stores, was with us at the Capitol yesterday with Harry Reid, with Leader Pelosi and others, talking about why she, as a business owner, pays the minimum wage and above, actually, for all of her employees because she has a loyal workforce. When you see that, you understand why this is an economic imperative. It's a moral imperative. It's a civil rights imperative. Nobody who works a full-time job in this country should have to live in poverty. And that is why we continue to fight in this regard. And you know what? I got to tell you, and to the students here, I've worked in local government. I've worked in state government. I've worked now in the federal government. I can't hold a job. Yeah, you might be thinking that. And frankly, there's a little truth to that. But the reality is, I encourage you to get involved at a local level, at a state level. Because I tell you, it started out as a prairie fire, and then it became kind of a little bit more than a prairie fire. Now it's a wildfire. It's a wildfire of fairness and opportunity across this country. You know, Connecticut just passed 10-10. Maryland's going to do it in a few days, I predict. D.C. has done it, except they're at 1150, along with Montgomery and Prince George's County. So get involved in this, Dr. King would say. You know, change doesn't initiate in Washington. Change all too frequently comes to Washington. We're going to keep fighting, but we're going to fight around this country, and we're going to need your help. And the minimum wage is not the only issue of wage fairness that we are working on. I was very excited and honored that Wade mentioned the work that we're doing on behalf of home health workers. Because one thing I recognized early on, and I recognize this in every job I take, is what are your tools? What can you do to make a difference and expand opportunity? You have the ability to initiate litigation. You have the ability to issue regulations. You have the ability to use your bully pulpit. You have the ability to use education, outreach. and partnership. You have the ability to issue guidance. And the regulatory authority of the Department of Labor is very important. And home health workers are almost 2 million strong, 90% women, 50% of color, and roughly 40% on food stamps and or some other form of public assistance. Let me tell you about food stamps for a moment, because I cannot tell you the number of workers that I meet who look me in the eye and tell me, Tom, I do not want to be on food stamps. But I can't help it. I have no choice. Well, there are actually two proposals right now pending in the United States Congress that would reduce the ranks of food stamps recipients by about 3.8 million people. One proposal is from the chair of the House Budget Committee, and that would simply slash the ranks, the eligibility, and slash the ranks of food stamp recipients. And the CBO has estimated that under that proposal, about 3.8 million less people would be on food stamps. Well, guess what? There's another proposal, and that's called 10-10, the minimum wage. And the Center for American Progress did a study, and it showed that you would save $4.6 billion a year in food stamps expenditures by raising the minimum wage. And by the way, raising the minimum wage doesn't cost a penny for the federal government. And guess how many people would no longer be eligible because they would be lifted above poverty? It just so happens that the number is 3.8 million. So, we've got two choices. And which choice would you take? I don't think I need to ask for a show of hands. But anyway, you know, the home health workers are a great example of why I love my job. Because it's not that often that, you know, you go home, you talk to my 11-year-old, and he says, Dad, what'd you do today? Well, I helped, you know, a couple million people get a raise. Because home health workers were treated under federal regulations for decades as no different than babysitters. Anybody who has employed a home health worker, and I have, when my mother's Alzheimer's got advanced, understands that they are doing anything but. They are indispensable professionals. And I am so proud that we were able to implement that regulation to give them the protections of the minimum wage and overtime laws that they so deserve. And I am so proud of that. But that's not all. In terms of addressing wage fairness, we have other tools. And the president recently directed us to address an issue that is a real challenge for some, and that is overtime. Overtime stands for a very simple proposition. If you work more, you should get paid more. But here's what happened in that context. In 2004, the Labor Department issued regulations, and they established a rule in which if you, they established a test in which you could be exempt from overtime protections if you were performing effectively management functions. The problem was, the way the rule is written, you can quite literally spend 1% of your time, and if you think I'm exaggerating, there is a Fourth Circuit case in which the worker was doing 1% of his work as management and 99% stocking shelves, and they were exempt from overtime protection. So what you have is a situation where people work 70 hours a week, they make $455, do the math. They're effectively working 10, 20, 30 hours for free. And we gotta fix that. Who are those people? You know, folks at the Dunkin' Donuts, a woman in Boston, she works 6 days a week, 9 hours a day. She actually thought she was making $10 an hour because they told her that. Well, actually, you do the math, $455, you're right at the poverty line again. And she was actually making about $8.50 an hour when you do the math on what she was getting paid. And so we gotta fix that. So we're reaching out to businesses, we're reaching out to workers, we're reaching out to all the stakeholders because once again, you know, for so many of these people, the opportunity quilt is fraying and we need to fix it. And we will continue to do that work. And that is one, yet another reason why I love my work. And I want to tell you about the work that we're doing that frankly keeps me up the most at night. There's a lot of things that keep me up, but this is the one that keeps me up the most. And we don't talk about it enough. And that is the plight of people who are long-term unemployed. You know, we had a good jobs report today. You know, we've had 49 consecutive months of private sector job growth to the tune of almost 9 million jobs. We, you know, remember when the president took office, we were hemorrhaging about 900,000 jobs a month, something like that. And we're moving in the right direction. We've got to pick up the pace. But one aspect of this recovery that remains vexing is the high percentage of people who are long-term unemployed. In the pre-recession period and in other normal times in the aftermath of recoveries from recessions, the long-term unemployment rate is about 1%. Currently, the long-term unemployment rate is about 2.4%. Let me translate that into numbers. That's like 3.5 million people. Or to put it differently, if we had pre-recession levels of long-term unemployment, we would have an overall unemployment rate of about 5.3% instead of 6.7. And we'd have 2 million plus less people unemployed. Well, let me stop talking about aggregate data, because this is all about people. And I spend a lot of time doing focus groups with these folks because their stories inspire me. I was in Cleveland last Friday, you know, and talking to a dozen long-term unemployed, and every single one of them and every single person I have ever met is working their tail off to find a job. I had a guy looking me in the eye and said, I got no quitting me, because I got a 10-year-old boy and I don't want my boy to think I'm quitting. And another guy from New Jersey who said, you know, I'm a cancer survivor. I had a chemo drip in me for weeks. And fighting cancer was a heck of a lot easier than fighting long-term unemployment. I got to know a woman, and I continue to communicate with her. Her name is Catherine Hackett. Catherine is a single mom, lives in Connecticut, a mother of two. One is Special Forces, currently in Afghanistan. The other is a doctor in the military. She's played by the rules all her life, just like all of the other people I've met. She is college educated. She was going to work one day. She worked in the healthcare sector. Was told, don't need your work anymore, don't need your services. Totally blindsided. And she looked and looked and looked. She couldn't find a job. She introduced the president at an event where we were talking about the plight of the long-term unemployed. And we struck up a friendship, and we got her some job leads, and she would email me. And let me just read you a couple of these emails. You know, Tom, I presented myself well today at the interview. I was extremely prepared. I have not heard anything yet, but I was told they would make a decision this week. The following day, for the first time since I'd been unemployed, I had a meltdown. Up to that point, I had remained positive, but I just felt mentally drained. I prepare, I rehearse. I learned the workings of the company. I memorize every answer to the questions that I think might be asked. It is so difficult to be overlooked time and time again. She didn't get that job. And she emailed me again and said, I had another interview today, and I don't know when that'll be decided, but I just asked my Marine how he has been trained to remain positive during dire situations. And he texted the following. It is important to find small victories. They taught us that during SERI school. SERI stands for Survival, Evasion, Resistance, and Escape. That's how the POWs in Vietnam stayed hopeful and positive despite their circumstances. And so to honor the hard work my son does, I will focus on finding small victories each day. This is exactly the type of folk I meet day in and day out. And they get you out of bed in the morning because they need our help. Next Monday, the Senate is going to vote on a bill extending unemployment benefits. Never in the history of Congress that I am aware of has Congress refused to extend emergency unemployment benefits for long-term unemployed when we have a long-term unemployment rate as high as we have now. Never until December of this past year. And 2 weeks ago, they said we weren't going to get anything done in the Senate. We worked our tails off, and we've got bipartisan bill that's going to pass the U.S. Senate on Monday. And we're going to get that through the House. We're going to keep fighting, because I know Dr. King, when he here, would be there doing it. And we need that help. We need your help. Because, you know, there were some, we got a letter in this case from an association of state workforce agencies saying it's really hard to administer benefits retroactively and all this other blobbity-blob stuff. And I'll tell you, I've been a state labor secretary, and by the way, retroactive benefits have only been done like 4 times in the last 2 years. If you're tired, get a new job. The burdens that states confront, and I can speak with some authority, pale in comparison to the burdens and challenges that Catherine Hackett and the millions of other folks are confronting. And so we wrote a letter back to Congress, and that was helpful in moving the ball forward. And if you're tired, get a new job. I really believe that. Because I'll tell you, I am not tired. I work hard, but I get inspired by these folks. And I tell people I work with, if you're tired, then don't come into work. We need people who got hop in their step. I got hop in my step, not just because of my knee replacement, but because of the work we've got to do. I got hop in my step because you know what? I see what's happening in my old job, and I see the issues that are happening in the voting context. I spent the majority or the bulk of my time at DOJ working on voting issues. And you know, it's amazing to me. You know, we're having this pitch battle about the future of our nation, and people have honest and serious disagreements about the nature of our democracy and the direction of our nation. And that's fine, that's the essence of democracy. But we shouldn't be sitting here and targeting our perceived foes and making it harder for them to exercise their right to vote. When I was at the department, we worked hard to make sure everybody had the right to vote. Whether you were a service member, whether you were someone who lived in Texas, whether you were a limited English proficient Asian American in the Bay Area, that's what we should be doing. We got some democracy maintenance to do, my friend. And you are at the forefront of it. You do that work here at UDC. I love coming here because you all understand that this is a mission-driven institution.
We can help with that.
And we need your help in that because we got a lot going on. You know, we got Equal Pay Day next week. You know, women are still taking it on the chin in the workplace all too frequently. Nuts and bolts discrimination that I see day in and day out. You know, pregnant women being told, you know, we don't need your help. You know, pregnant women seeking to get a mortgage being told, you know, you're going to have to get PMI, you know, private mortgage insurance, because, you know, I don't know if you're going to be coming back to work. That's illegal, folks. And we address that in my old job. So we got some democracy maintenance to do, and we've got some opportunity building to do. We've got an opportunity quilt that for all too many folks is frayed. And I am confident that we can do more. I am confident that we will succeed because, you know what, we are on the right side of these issues. You know, we stand for something. We stand for opportunity. We think we should expand the right for all eligible people to vote. We think we should expand the right for people to get access to affordable health insurance. We stand for opportunity in the workplace for people, regardless of your religion, regardless of who you love, regardless of your race. And the beauty of this is the arc of the moral universe shifts toward justice for people who stand for opportunity, not simply people whose basic premise is to be against everything. And that is why I come to you and I leave you tonight with an unremitting sense of optimism. Because I look at history and folks who stand for something, inclusion, expanding opportunity, those folks have won in the previous battles, and those folks, we folks, will continue to win in the future. We got to be persistent. And you know, there are days when you get, you know, kicked in certain parts of the anatomy, but you know, as the civil rights song goes, we fall down and we get up. And we continue to get up. And we're persistent. Civil Rights Act of 64 was first introduced in 1948. It took persistence. Fighting poverty will take persistence. Fighting poverty will take partnership. Fighting poverty will take leadership. Fighting poverty will take law schools like this great law school, continuing to be at the forefront of these issues. And I am confident you will. And I am confident we will succeed. And I leave you with one final point. Catherine Hackett has a job. Yeah.
And this is why we are proud to have him both as our Secretary of Labor and as our 22nd annual Rauh Lecturer. Tom, thank you so much.
And finally, I just want to say with great appreciation, Secretary Thomas E. Perez, 22nd Annual Joseph L. Rauh Jr. Lecture, April 4th, 2014, University of the District of Columbia, David A. Clarke School of Law, the Dean's Cup.